All right, so today we're going to do Are You Covenanted Part 35. Yay! Now, because this is also the first day of unleavened bread, and there are those that will watch this in the future and go, oh, okay, so that's when this was being done. I know that a lot of people would think that we should be doing something about either the Exodus out of Egypt or, you know, what Yeshua did in his death, burial, and resurrection or something like that. But you have to understand this is actually a very appropriate teaching to be doing at this time because the purpose of both of those things was so that you could be covenanted. And so it is appropriate that we're doing a teaching on covenant during this time frame because the reason they left Egypt was to go to covenant. And the reason that Yeshua did what he did is so that our covenanting actually had value. Amen. That there was something at the end of it called eternal life. Okay? And so there is a direct connection to these things. And I think that it's very important that we understand that. And so, of course, the real reason is because I just didn't have time to write something else. Okay, so, you guys paying attention? Okay. No, seriously, I think that it is appropriate that we are dealing with the whole idea of covenant. And actually, and I keep saying this like every so often we have a teaching series, but these, I think each one of these is like the most important thing that we could possibly be studying. Because really, when it comes down to it, when I said during the like Are You Saved series, understanding salvation, faith and works and all that stuff, I thought was so critical. But all of this wraps around back to the relationship. And the relationship that we're striving towards or developing, we're working towards, is a relationship with our Heavenly Father and our Messiah in the context or in the vehicle known as covenant. And so learning about covenant is critical, and that's why we spent 35 parts, roughly 40 hours talking about it, okay? Well, we haven't quite gotten there yet because I haven't done part 35. We're doing it now. And so we've been in Proverbs 5 because as we've been going through this beautifully written, the wisdom that was given to Shlomo, to Solomon, we're seeing that there was a need sometimes to expand on and expound on some of the concepts he was encouraging his son or through the metaphor of it, all of us. As his children, speaking to his son as a father to a son, and the father of all, speaking through him to all of us. And so we are continuing here in Proverbs chapter 5 and in verse 7. Now, we are again reminded that this all has to do with not understanding what covenant is. We covered that for the first 20-something parts. This has now been more about wisdom, knowledge, and understanding and how they relate to our covenant keeping. Because ultimately, the big problem with everything that we're doing, I would guess we would all agree, is not a mechanical one, okay? It's not the mechanics that are tough, how we eat, what days we keep, and those kind of things. It's the emotional part behind it, the understanding and the wisdom and the knowledge, etc., behind it. That help us make better choices, help us treat. Because remember, the relationship is loving each other, loving our Creator. It isn't just the mechanics of it. I can provide you with everything you need in a relationship and not be very nice about it. Not be very loving about it, but I can physically provide the mechanics of the relationship. And our Father doesn't want this to be a mechanical thing. Now, He gives us instructions and expects us to obey them. But He wants us to do it in a relational way, which has to do with our understanding what wisdom, knowledge, and understanding are. And we go back to verse 1 where He says, my son, listen to my wisdom, incline your ear to my understanding, and watch over discretion, and your lips will guard knowledge. And of course, we have to always keep reminding ourselves that knowledge is not, in this case, an informational thing. It's a relational thing. And some of us are struggling because we're still dealing with it on an informational level, not a relational level. And so now we get to verse 7. Now remember, we just dealt with verse 1 and 2 where He says, this is what I want you to do. Then verse 3 through 6, but beware, there's this temptation that will come in the metaphor of the woman with the honey lips and the smooth words and all that kind of stuff. And then we get to verse 7. He says, so now that I just gave you the comparison between these two things, listen to me, you children. Okay, now nobody get offended. He just called you children. Recognize that nowhere in Scripture do I see the reference to the men of Israel. It's always the children of Israel. Now, probably there's a verse, someone's going to go find it where it said the men of Israel. But they're always referred to as the children of Israel. because we have a growing up and maturing process that we seem to struggle with more than anything else. It also tells us to remind us that we are his children. So it's not just about being immature, but that's where we struggle. I mean, we have to admit it. We are struggling is always in that growing into the fullness of the completeness of Messiah, as expressed in Ephesians chapter 4. That, remember, we were told the fivefold ministry is supposed to be there for you until we all come into the fullness and completeness that is Messiah Yeshua. And it's not about the mechanics. All of us can get the mechanics down, and most of us probably have most of it down. As a matter of fact, the only place you stumble in a lot of the mechanics is because of the other side of growing up, where you're still trying to be self-sovereign about the way you want to apply the mechanics. That's how we fight about things like, you know, what defines Shabbat? Is it sundown to sundown? Is it morning to morning? Is it this to this? Is it what kind of moon are we looking at? Or, you know, is it, you know, whatever it is about the nature of some other thing that's the mechanics? And that's not a problem with the mechanics. That's a problem with the growing and maturing and learning from who you're supposed to learn from. And we're going to talk about that here in a second. So he says, so now listen to me, you children, and do not turn away from the words of my mouth. So point one, you want to write it down somewhere, is do not turn away. So he gave us the comparison, verses 1 and 2, and then verses 3 through 6. And he's saying, look, understanding that these two choices and opportunities are there, do not turn away. This is an active thing that you choose to do. You have to actively turn your body and walk in a different direction. Do not turn away. Do not reject, do not turn away from the words of my mouth. Now notice that there's a consistent play on those, on that way of wording this. Exodus 19, the covenant. If you will obey the words and my voice and everything comes out of my mouth. So we're always about his words and obeying his words. Problem is, we also want to decide for ourselves what his words mean. And we have to allow him to define his own stuff. He says, do not turn away from the words of my mouth. Keep your way far from her. So point two, keep your way far from. These are active things. Look, you were raised probably, not all of you, but most of you, in some sort of a mainstream church environment. And in that environment, I promise you, I may not have ever been there, but I've heard enough to know that you probably were not instructed that you have to be on top of everything yourself. That mostly it was all done for you, you just had to accept that. Is that correct? Okay. Listen to the words we're reading here in your book. Everybody's translation, I'm sure, says very much the same thing. He wants you to not turn away, and he wants you to keep your way from. Don't just rely on, well, I recognize Messiah is Messiah. Okay, I'm good now. Okay? You need to actively make the effort to keep your way from her, the one we read about in verses 3 through 6 and spent a couple of weeks on, and do not come near the door of her house. Some of you don't recognize the addiction that you have. Ooh, don't be mean to us, Rabbi. If you were an alcoholic, you know you can't enter a bar. You can't enter a place where people are drinking because the temptation would be problematic. If you see people drinking, you know you need to turn around and get away from that. All addictions are like that. I just use alcohol because it's a very simple one to mention that most people understand. Even if you've never been in that place, you've seen it, you've experienced it through other people, so you understand. But all addictions work the same. In other words, once you recognize the addiction, you have to avoid any possibility of spending any time near or around it because you will be tempted to do it, to partake. And so a lot of you are watching teachers or listening to stuff or videos or whatever it is or hanging out with people that are going to tempt you like the woman with the lips. Okay, I'm not just talking about the secular stuff here. I'm talking about this stuff. This is stuff where he's saying, my son, you've been instructed, but there'll be those who you'll run into that are going to pervert and twist the instruction and it's going to sound good to you. You're being instructed here. He says, keep your way far from her and do not come even near her door. Because some of you think, oh, I can handle it. I'm strong. It doesn't bother me. I'm not going anywhere. And then later on, I'm like, where did so-and-so go? Anybody seen him? Anybody seen her? Gone. Because you think, just like that alcoholic or whoever it is, whatever it is you have a problem with, oh, I can just handle one beer. No, you can't. You're addicted. Someone who's not addicted, yes. But generally, you are, and I think this is something we can all admit, whatever your addiction is, there's a blind spot there where you don't, it takes a long time for you to realize you actually are addicted. So you think you can handle what you can't handle. And you will blindly, because of that blind spot, you will argue with everybody, I'm not an alcoholic, I'm not a whatever-aholic, I'm not addicted to whatever it is I'm addicted to. I can handle it. Isn't that what they all say? What are you talking about? I'm handling it just fine. No. Not really. And that goes for all the addictions. Okay? I'm just using one as an example. And so if you have that, if alcohol is your thing, I'm not picking on you. It's just one of the more commonly understood ones. It makes for a good example. But trust me, all addictions are equally insidious, debilitating, and wrecking of lives. Okay? I'm using one for the example. And so he's telling you here, he says, look, do not come near the door of her house. Because you will be tempted by the honey lips, by the temptation of that thing that sounds good to you, because it appeals to your self-sovereignty, which I'm talking about is not it appeals to you because it lets you be in charge. It appeals to you because it's what you would prefer. It's the way you would rather things be. And I don't know about you, but I counsel a lot of people that they call me after they've already watched 15 other teachers on a particular topic, fishing and searching for that one teacher definitively to give them the confidence that what they want is right. Because they're really not looking just for what is right. They're looking for someone to say that what they prefer is actually right. And if they hear too much confusion, they keep looking for some teacher that they finally believe maybe they'll recognize the authority of and hope that they'll agree with them. I watched this, the first time I've ever seen this, I remember when I came into my only church experience and the place that I went to was a Torah observant place, etc., in the context of Messiah, but that place had a pastor leave and a new one come in. And you know, we had a little Bible study and people got to write up questions with for the new pastor to answer. And absolutely, and this happened more than once. We had like one, they moved them around, whatever. Every time we got a new pastor, the questions were always to see if the pastor would allow them to do what they want to do. Well, is it okay to blah, 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 blah? Because they're looking for someone to say, yeah, it's okay to do what you want to do. Because they know the other pastor didn't let them do it. And so some of you do that with the internet. The internet is much easier than having to sit in a room and ask somebody, or the rabbi or the pastor in front of the room. Just go on the internet and find teachers. Look up your subject. The subject of marriage and divorce. The subject of, how the calendar works. The subject of whatever. And you're going to find every possible spectrum of teaching from every part of the possible ways to approach it. And that's why I've told you over and over again, you need to find a teacher. That doesn't mean you can't listen to other things, but you need a teacher to go to that you trust enough to say, hey, teacher, I had this thing I was watching and I did this and I'm not sure what to do now. And that teacher could say, well, here's what you need to do. And you trust it. Now, if you don't have a teacher like that, you just keep looking. You need to find one that you can do that with. But don't just keep looking for, and I've told you guys as many times, I don't like people to call me as part of an opinion poll. If you want counsel, I'd love to give you counsel. And I'm not just wanting to give you an opinion to add to your list. Okay, I've got 14 yeses and 13 noes. Yeah. Oh, Rabbi, I got 12 and 12. I need someone to break the tie. Well, go watch 20 more videos. We have to be careful of our addictions, okay? We're all addicted to us, ourselves, and how we feel about everything. We're addicted to, I need to feel safe and comfortable, but through my own filters. And we have a very big time with, big challenge with trust. And actually, that's really the biggest thing that you see happening in the whole covenant thing going on in this book, in your scriptures, is the problem with trusting. Can they trust Yahweh? And most of the time, you see they don't. And that's what the father in this story here in Proverbs, Solomon is telling us in that position of father, you need to trust. Can you trust me? He says, don't even go near the house. Don't go near the door. Stay away. Because, oh, but I can handle it. Well, okay. I've had people tell me that. There's a lot of really good, really smart, when I say good, meaning really well-educated and trained, you know, Jewish teachers out there from mainstream Judaism. And some of you, if you watch them, you will leave this behind and run into Judaism. Some of you, it won't bother you at all. You'll be able to understand that they're helping to understand whatever topic it is, whatever. But you might not know where you're at. I would rather tell you, you know what? You don't need to go there. There's a lot enough for you to do first. And I love the people that say to me, well, can you recommend some place I can go to go deeper into this stuff? And I'm like, you're struggling with this. Go deeper. You want to chew a steak, you don't have any teeth. Take the nipple and the bottle out of your mouth and then maybe you could start to chew on something. I'm not trying to be offensive. I'm just saying is some of you, because you don't want to deal with your struggles with the basics, you want to go into the more esoteric and interesting and extreme stuff because it gives you a sense, you convince yourself that you're moving forward when you're moving sideways. Okay? Receive that. You want to go into these other areas because it makes you feel like you're growing forward when you're going sideways. I'm not picking on those other topics, but there's no point to going in that direction if you're still struggling with the ABCs. And that's the whole thing. Oh, well, I'm not struggling with that stuff. Okay. I don't know if you're qualified to make that judgment. You may need to counsel with somebody to see if you're struggling or not. And that's why there's structure in Scripture and counsel and teachers. Because we're not qualified. Look, generally speaking, you're not qualified to diagnose yourself. Medically, emotionally, spiritually, it doesn't matter. Physically, on any kind of level. We go and ask people to tell us and evaluate where we're at in those areas. Anybody been to a gym? One of the first things the big gym chains want to do is what? Take measurements and test you out and figure out where you're at. They're going to diagnose your level of health, fitness-wise. Isn't that true? You don't just walk in and say, well, I'm in pretty good shape and blah, blah, blah. No, they said, we're going to go ahead and put you through a little series of figuring out where you're at. Give you a professional opinion. Okay? But yet we feel like we can do all this stuff ourselves, for ourselves. So people, I mean, I can't tell you how many people. I have one person I'm thinking of right now, and not here, person's not here, but there's one or two people I think of right now who came to me and wanted to go study further, deeper. Oh, the whole thing came out to deeper. Actually, we lost the whole congregation to wanting to be deeper. Okay, in Cincinnati. Well, we want to go deeper. So they want to go into the rabbis, and they want to go into those guys that are trained in deeper. And what they ended up with is no Yeshua and in Judaism. And that can happen where you have Yeshua, but you have this perverted thing that then he says to you, get away from me, I didn't know you. And so let's be really careful with it because we're going to see very strong statements here in another couple of verses that deal exactly with what I'm saying and back me up 100%. So do not come near the door of her house, lest you give your splendor to others and your years to one who is cruel, lest strangers be filled with your strength and your labors go to the house of the foreigner. So what he's saying here is, if you don't do what you were called to do, he will find somebody else to do it. That's what he's saying here in simple terms. Like, remember what Esther was told. Hey, you need to do this, but if you don't, somebody will. And you will have lost your opportunity. Because this is going to happen. Yahweh will rescue us. But will it be you as the vehicle? Well, the same thing here. If you do not do, he says, listen to me. Don't turn away. Keep away from her. Stay far away. Don't even go near her door. Because if you do these things, you risk giving your splendor to others. You risk letting others be filled with your strength and your labors go to the house of a foreigner. All your work, all your efforts will go to somebody else. It's a strong warning. He says, then, oh, listen now, this is so human nature. Then you're going to howl in your latter end when your flesh and your body are consumed. Look, we see this in children. I see it in children and in adults because I get to counsel that. You see this in children. They do when they do their own thing, their own way, and it blows up in their face, and then they get upset about it. Not upset like, ow, it hurt, but like they're mad that they didn't get away with what they wanted to get away with, or what they did doing it their way didn't work. And now when they lose out, because you told them, well, if you do that, I'm going to take away your stuff. Or if you do that, you're going to lose something else. And then we don't want consequences. That's what this is saying. Don't do this because you will get consequences, and you're going to howl about how unfair the consequences are. Isn't that what he's talking about here? Oh, then you're going to howl in the latter end. Oh, it's not fair that I lost my splendor and my strength was given to strangers. And why is that not fair? You got your opportunity. You squandered it. Whose fault is that? Well, it's not fair. I should have been allowed to do whatever I wanted and still got what I wanted. That doesn't work that way. We see children do that, though. Aren't we supposed to grow up from that? He says, then you're going to howl and say, how I have hated. Listen now, this is the problem right here. Verse 12 and 13 is what really caused the problem. Because of their self-sovereignty, because of the me, I desire thing, they shall say, how I have hated discipline and my heart has despised reproof. So they've hated. Now the word there in the Hebrew is better translated in a sense, turned against like an enemy. So they've turned against discipline like an enemy. In other words, those of us who do the disciplining, you now look at us as like we're enemies. Yahweh does the disciplining, you treat him like he's an enemy. How dare he discipline me, or how dare you discipline me? And my heart has despised reproof. The Hebrew there has a deeper understanding of spurned it or mocked and insulted it. Anybody give someone reproof and they just laugh at you and mock you and like, oh yeah, whatever, you know. And or like you give them reproof like, I'm glad that thing blew up in my face and I don't care. That's the attitude. It's awful. And all of us have those moments. And so let's understand, he says, this is why you're having the problems. You've hated discipline. Your heart despised reproof. And listen to the verse 13. And I have not heeded the voice of my head. Of myself. No, my teachers. I didn't listen. See, some of you think, Rabbi, did you mess with my book? How do you always seem to find verses to talk about this stuff? Man, that's all this guy ever talks about is teachers, blah, blah, blah. I don't know. Proverbs chapter 5 and verse 13 was always there. And by the way, it was in all the other 57 million places we've been reading it for the last 35 parts. And all the other teachings where we keep bringing it up. Do you think maybe we could finally take a hint? So now it's not just me telling you, you need a teacher. And it's not telling me you need to find one you can trust and listen to. Here Solomon is saying, the reason you got all screwed up and you're all whining and complaining in the end is because you did not listen to the voice of your teacher. He said, I have not inclined my ear to those who instructed me. Now, why would somebody do those two things? Because they knew better. Well, I know better. Why don't I listen to them? They're wrong. I'm right. One of my favorite things, I've mentioned this before, that I love. It's like my favorite thing. It makes me laugh every time. And it's not a pride and ego thing. It's about me thinking about where they are in their mindset. When they send me an email or something like, hey, listen, I'm just so glad I met you. You know, I really appreciate your teachings. Hey, you're right about most of it. I'm so glad you gave me that endorsement. Let me write that down. Somebody I never heard of, name whatever, just told me that I'm right about most things. Okay, good. I don't even know what their qualifications are to give me that wonderful endorsement. From Fiddler on the Roof, it's not every day one gets such a compliment. Or gets a compliment like that. That's the line. There you go. And some of the people out there can say, well, this guy just wants everybody to listen to him. I didn't say that. I never said that. But if I'm your teacher, you need to do that. And if I'm not your teacher, you need to find one. And then you need to do that. Okay? So that's what he's saying. He says, look, I have not heeded the voice of my teachers, and I have not inclined my ear to those who instructed me. Now, let's pause there and understand the problem. There's a very simple problem. Okay? It's called submission. We don't understand it. We talk about it a lot, and we have a problem with it because we don't understand the essence of it. Submission is not even an issue until you don't like or you disagree with the one you're submitting to. But what most of you will do is because you don't like it and you disagree, you'll just walk away and run away and say, that guy's an idiot. Of course, the person was the best thing since sliced bread before they were an idiot. And you post it all over your Facebook page and everything else, and now you've triggered out to delete all that stuff. Because after all, now they're an idiot because you didn't like something. But submission comes only at that moment. Ladies, that's what you have at your house if you're married. Children have that with their parents. And men, you have that if you can get into an alignment with vertically with your ministry, with your leadership. But I can promise you, in the position I'm in all three of those levels, I see almost none. I see almost none. I know because I counsel the people that are struggling with this. Blah, 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 blah. I said, well, because you won't submit. What do you mean? Well, he's wrong or she's wrong or this one. Ah, why is that even relevant? Are you trusting them in their position? If you do, you submit. Submission doesn't mean they have to be right. They could still be wrong, but now it's their problem, not yours. But this is why this is happening here. I did not listen. It says, look, I have not heeded the voice of my teachers and have not inclined my ear to those who instructed me. Why would someone do that? Because they didn't like what was said. They thought they knew better or whatever. They just didn't want to do it because they preferred something different. And their preferences won out. Well, I appreciate that, counsel, but I think you're an idiot because I don't like what you said. Now, none of you really think that way necessarily, or maybe some do, who knows? But the thing is, the way you act expresses that. It's a relational thing that we're working at. In that relationship, it doesn't mean the person you have the relationship with has to be perfect. You have to choose that you're trusting them to do the job, and it's their problem to fix it when it's not perfect, not yours. If you're a wife, it's the husband's job. If you're a parent, it's your job, not the child's. If you're a man, you need to find a man to be under and be submitted to who can speak into your life, and you're not going to go, oh, they hurt my feelings. Because some of you men would not like it when I, you know, if I were to tell you quite frankly what I was thinking in those moments and how you're acting like a little child. And you're acting like worse than the ones that you pick on when you tell me about your wife or your kids. I'm like, but look at you. You really will not know. All of you that when you, if you're not married, if you're going to get married, or if you've been married, you understand what I'm talking about. You don't know what marriage is like till you're married. I don't care. I can't teach it to you. Nobody can teach it to you. You will only know for sure once you get married because the context can only be understood in it. Do you understand what I'm saying here? Life is about context. Not like I'm saying with the verses, like who's speaking, etc. This is another level of context I want to talk about. Life is about context. Let me give you an example. How many of you ever wondered, this came up in a conversation the other night, how many of you ever wondered why Yeshua, I mean, after all, he's the Messiah, he was slain before the foundation of the earth, he offered himself freely, would sit there in the garden and pray, freely say, Father, if it's possible to take this cup away from me, can that be done? Was he afraid? No. Was he panicking? No. What was different then than at the foundation before the foundation of the earth? What was different? The context of him now being in flesh and knowing what that feels like. He had a concept of it before the foundation of the earth. He agreed to do what would be done before the foundation of the earth. But what did he say, though, in the context of it? He said, nevertheless, I submit fully to you, Father, whatever you say. And do you notice that once that conversation ended, he just got up and did what he had to do. There was never another word about it. He didn't whine, didn't complain, didn't gripe, didn't have an attitude problem. Did you notice that? But there was a context change. He had a concept of human life until that time. Now he understood in a full context what it felt like to be us. It says he's been tempted in all things as we were, as we are. He knows what it feels like inside, in our hearts, in our emotions, in our minds, in our physical bodies, to feel pain, etc. None of those things did he have any understanding of before the foundation of the earth. Just like in 1 John, we have the opposite of it. We have a hard time contextually understanding what it's like to be them.
Well, I want to transform into the image of the Son, and I want to transform.
Well, you don't understand what even that looks like. You have concepts about it, but you don't have any context yet, which is why John in 1 John says, I don't know what we will be like, except that I know that when we see him, when he comes in and we're changed into that, then we'll have context. And we'll see him and understand him as he is. Is this making sense? Okay? And so you say, oh, I want to be a disciple. Oh, I want to live in that first century model. You have no context to know what that feels like and is because you live now. You don't have anybody doing that around now. You can't see what that looks like. You can't even get the concept in visual because you can't even watch it being done now anywhere. I have so many people that have come to me and said, will you be my covering or can I disciple with you? And I promise you, almost none of them probably truly understand because they don't have the context yet what they're asking for. They just don't. I had a gentleman one time that when we were talking about something and there was something that he didn't want to do, and he said to me, he said, Rabbi, please don't make me do it. And I said, I won't. I said, but don't tell everybody you're discipling with me either. Because if you're discipling, if I say do it, you do it. So I'm not going to. Because that's a disciple level thing. I will never interfere or insert myself in your life unless you invite me in a relationship that is correct for that, my inserting myself. Do you understand what I'm saying? In a disciple level relationship, you've given me that permission to speak freely, for out of love and out of truth, unfettered, straight. But if you don't want that, don't say, well, I want to be your disciple. Because that's what we all think. That's what the ultimate thing. I want a disciple. But are you ready to trust anybody that much? Are you ready to trust a physical person? Because discipleship is done by people. By the way, Yeshua trained 12. If you want to look at the 70 or 120, but let's look at the 12. And he sent them out to do what? To make disciples throughout the nations. And so they were trained, having the context and the experience of what that looks like to do it with others. But we want to, oh, I want to be a disciple. First of all, we don't have the physical structure to handle that because you'd have to really be where I am if I'm doing it, or whoever your teacher is, you'd have to live where they are to be able to do this like Yeshua did. He kind of almost lived with them, right? Went around and spent all that time with them. And discipling is a very intimate and intense relationship. As close to husband-wife as people can be that are not married, or like as close as father and son or father and daughter, who are not actually physically father and son, father and daughter, okay? Or whatever that is. Women can be discipling other ladies too. It says that the older women are supposed to be training up the younger ones. So it's as much as a mother with a daughter. But can you trust? Well, I don't know. My mother and I had a terrible relationship. My father and I had a terrible. See, you don't have context for it. You don't have the framework to understand what you're asking for because your experiences have been completely the opposite and terrible. And so understand what he's talking about here. He says, look, my son, listen to my wisdom, incline your ear to my understanding. Not our understanding, his understanding. And then he says, your problem is that you're not listening to your teachers. Some of you have a bigger problem before that, which is finding the teacher. You got to find one first. But then you got to find one that you will listen to. Well, I don't like the way you said that. Why is that relevant? There's a lot of things Yahweh says here that are not very nice and don't come across as all warm and fuzzy. You going to whine about that too? I didn't like the way you said that. Well, I'm growing too. But how I said it shouldn't matter. What I said should matter. If I'm your teacher, whoever your teacher is. Because maybe you needed it to come that way because you needed to have your feelings stepped on, which, by the way, they should all be picked up and put in the feelings bag. We will have them at the marketplace eventually. Okay. We have a few who've made their own. Okay. And they carry it around. It actually says feelings bag on it. They're very cute. See, Michelle's got one right there. Okay. All right. Okay. Some of you need like a feelings U-Haul. Okay. Like an 18-wheeler, okay? That's probably why you needed to have it come the way it did. Maybe you've had enough coddling. Maybe you've had enough, you know, codependency. Maybe you've had enough people allowing you to just sit there, thumb in the mouth with the diaper on. I'm just saying, all of us are capable of being in that spot. I'm not picking on anybody. That includes me, okay? I'm just saying I would rather somebody just get in my face and tell me straight. Don't beat around the bush. Give it to me, tell me, don't waste my time. Don't coddle me, don't hint at it. Because by the way, most of you who say you'd like it to be more gentle and hinted at, you don't get the hint. I've tried that method. Doesn't seem to work very well, okay? But this has to do with context. You have to start to now have the context of understanding what a covenanted person in a relationship with our Messiah and our Creator should look like and behave like. We've got information, we've got concepts, and you have to start applying them to get more context. And you're not going to really know where you are until it goes bad. When I mean bad, meaning the way you will feel when you don't like what's happening or you disagree and you're being put in a place to have to make a choice that you don't want to. Because then you're going to choose, am I going to trust or am I going to run? Or am I going to badmouth that? Well, you have no idea what that guy just said to me, blah, 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 treated me like this. When I kissed his mouth, uh-oh. That's a good timing on that, uh-oh. Because I'll have a few of those conversations and I'll leave those conversations going, uh-oh, we're going to find out now where we're at. All right, we're going to find out now. This is not verse 13. This is not, and I know a lot of people will try to maybe spin this. This is not metaphorically trying to talk about the Ruach. It's not talking just about Yeshua. It's talking about physical teachers. They were supposed to always be. We did a teaching called Learn and Teach the Torah. Probably need to redo it. Okay? It was like 3 or 4 parts. Now it'll be 28. And so, you know, we'll get to redo that at some point. But understand, that teaching makes the case from Scripture that there always were, supposed to be and always were, physical human being teachers that we were supposed to be learning from. All the way to where Paul says it. And Paul says, until there should be teachers, evangelists, apostles, etc. Until, and we haven't gotten to the until we've all come into the fullness and completeness, etc. of Messiah. That has not happened. So we're still in the until as far as, so if you like Paul, if Paul's your hero, well, that's what Paul said in Ephesians 4. Deal with it. Okay? Now, we're not talking Moses, we're not talking Solomon, Paul says that. Now, you need a teacher, because that's one of those five. And they're supposed to be there for what? For the perfecting of the body. Perfecting of the saints, as it translates in English a lot of times, to the fullness of the maturity of the character of Yeshua. Physical human being teachers are to be around, but they're only the selected ones with anointing and appointing, not just anybody who out there puts out a teaching. Okay? If I sit down at a piano and start playing, it doesn't make me a piano player. If I pick up a guitar and start playing, it doesn't make me a guitar player. If I pick up a paintbrush and start using paint on a canvas, it doesn't make me a painter. Just because someone posts a teaching, it doesn't make them a teacher. Understand that. Be careful with that. Just because someone does something that is teaching doesn't make them actually a teacher. And actually, some of the ones who are the worst out there, not because their teachings are so bad, but they're so tempting to you, is because they did put out some reasonably good stuff, and then they really started to feel like, from the rhetoric that they're hearing and the accolades from everybody else, how wonderful they are, they now believe themselves to be teachers. And then they start to run with it. Oh, I'm a teacher. Oh, I guess I'm a teacher. I better start putting out teachings. And then they put out more and bigger stuff, and it gets worse and worse. Because they don't have what they need to be that thing. They're not qualified. Takes an anointing and an appointing. Okay? I'll give you an example with myself. I play 11 instruments poorly. That was a little pause to react. I have no problem understanding the technical and mechanical aspects of picking up almost any instrument and figuring out how to play it within short order. But I have no gifting in any of them necessarily to play them well. Okay? Nor do I necessarily have the gifting and the calling to be drawn to it, to obsess on it, which is what you need to play it well, where you just sit there and play all day long. I had a friend, I remember the first time I kind of understood this, I had a friend in high school that every time I was at his house, no matter what we were doing, if we weren't doing something physical, he was sitting and talking, he had a guitar in his hand, and he was just kind of quietly playing while we were talking. Something I would never do. But yet, I do that with this. If we're sitting around, somehow it's going to come back to this. It's going to come to something instructional in my role as a teacher almost always. Because that's what I obsess on. That's what I'm called to. I'm not saying that if you're obsessed on it, that means you're called to it. I'm just giving you some of the ideas. A lot of people are obsessed about things that they're terrible at and will never be good at because it's not their calling. That doesn't mean that you shouldn't do it. Just don't start calling yourself a painter or a teacher or a guitar player if that's just not something you have the giftings for. The talents for. And recognize that that's okay. You do have giftings and talents somewhere. Appreciate those. Okay? But also recognize that just because someone posts a teaching, it doesn't make them a teacher. Okay? Let's continue, because I did say I want to get through chapter 5 today. We're close. Okay, verse 14. In a little while, I was in all evil in the midst of an assembly and a congregation. Now, here's the context. This is the person that didn't necessarily keep away from her, didn't avoid going to the door, was worried, didn't avoid giving splendor to others and being all that stuff, didn't listen to their teachers, hated reproof, hated discipline, despised all these things. And you know what it caused? It caused the person for a little while to be in all evil. Because out of all that stuff comes what's known as evil. So what's evil? Anything that goes against how Yahweh intended it. If something was meant to be used a certain way by Yahweh, if you use it for some other purpose. If you were, by the way, called, designed, created to be set apart and be His. And to function and walk in this thing called Torah observance. In the character of Yeshua with the fruit of the Spirit. Loving each other and loving Him. When you don't do that, it's evil. Any aspect of it that you don't do is evil. So when you take anything that he says and you twist or pervert it to a slightly off type of way, that's evil. And so from the honey lips and the despising reproof and hating discipline and all that other stuff, we end up in a place with all evil. Everything is now twisted and perverted and not the way Yahweh intended. So you could read that verse, and I would have read this verse years ago and just thought, evil, okay, that's just like horrible, mean, just the worst possible people in this kind of stuff, like, rapists and pillaging and murderings and whatever, right? No. In a little while, I was in all evil in the midst of an assembly and a congregation. So a congregation that was doing things perverted and twisted from the way Yahweh intended. See how quickly you can end up in a group of people. If you follow this pattern leads to being in the midst of an assembly of people all doing it that way. And now you really feel like you've arrived when you couldn't be further away. And it doesn't matter that the congregation maybe is only a little off on a few things. You're furthest away because you think you've arrived. The person that knows they haven't arrived, who's much further away, they're actually closer than you are because they know they haven't arrived and they're going to try to get to where they need to go. You're stopping. You think you're there. You might as well be a million miles away because you're not going to make any effort to move the few feet you're off. He says, drink water from your own cistern and running water from your own well. Should your springs be scattered abroad, rivers of water in the streets? He says, this is what was going on. So he's in a congregation, an assembly. He's in the midst of all this evil, the stuff that's being done incorrectly. And part of the reason is because people are drinking water from their own cisterns instead of from the river of living waters flowing out of Yeshua, from the Torah, from Yahweh. They're drinking from their own cisterns and running water from their own well. If you drink out of your own well, all you're going to get is what you've got there. You know, this was said to me by Harold, who's here. He said, you know, if you're not careful, you end up where you're going. Think about that for a second. If you're not careful, you end up where you're going. Remember when you told me that? And so I love it. That's a great point. But how do you end up there? You end up there by choice. You either choose to follow yourself, follow somebody else, follow Yeshua, follow the Father. You have to choose. And by the way, if you just allow yourself to be buffeted and pushed and just kind of wherever you end up, you're still making a choice. You still have chosen to go that way. He says, should your springs be scattered abroad, rivers of water in the streets? Let them be only your own and not for strangers with you. Let your fountain be blessed and rejoice with your wife of your youth. Now he says, look, instead of allowing all that to be scattered and all this stuff, why don't you start to watch over it, fill it with the rivers of water, and then watch so that it doesn't go everywhere. He said, let your fountain be blessed and rejoice with the wife of your youth. The wife of the youth is now the metaphor of, son, listen to me. Wisdom is the bride you want, not this woman with the honey lips. He said, a loving deer and a pleasant doe, let her breast satisfy you at all times and be captivated by her love always. So what is it talking about? Well, by letting her breast satisfy you. It's like a babe nurturing for the milk, the suckling. We're not talking about this from a sexual point of view. It's more from you are satisfied because you're getting fed at the bosom of this, of the wisdom. Okay, you know, to come out of her, my people, and worrying about the mother of harlots, a lot of people are sitting there suckling at the breast of the harlots. They've got all of that stuff jammed in their mouth. And then that's what comes out. And so he's saying, no. He says, rejoice at the wife of your youth. Focus on her. He says, for why should you, my son, be captivated by a strange woman and embrace the bosom of a foreigner? Then we take it now to the sexual side. Men are designed to be attracted to the women's physical parts of the body. He said, why are you attracted to other women? Why are you attracted? Be attracted to your wife. And so he says, don't go after that. Don't be captivated by a strange woman. So we take the metaphor in those two directions. You've got the one of the suckling, and you also have the one of the more of the bonding sexual stuff. The sexuality was meant to take two, make them one, and bind them. Of course, if you go and spread that all over the place, what are you bound to? Everybody? You lose the uniqueness of all of that. It's supposed to be that glue. So he's saying, look, you got the wife of your youth. She's gorgeous and wonderful, and you have the embrace of her bosom. Why are you going to go and be captivated by a strange woman? Well, but I like hers better. Why? Well, was it maybe because you didn't really think that well when you made your choice? And I'm not talking about from the physical, like who you married, but the same thing is here. It's a metaphor. But it could also go to the physical. I mean, none of us probably had a whole lot of conversation with anybody of guidance and counsel before we selected our spouse. The two biggest things we do in life, we get no training for. We get married and we have babies. You need a license to drive a car. You don't need a license necessarily to have a baby. I mean, you have to take a course and you have to pass a test to drive a car. You don't have to do anything to go out and have kids. And then, you know, you have a license to screw them up as any way you want. After all, that's what was done to you, your parents. And that's what we end up with. I looked at my wife when we took my son home from the hospital, and all we had to do to qualify was figure out how to get the car seat in. Wow, we're good parents now. We got this covered. I clicked it in and it worked, and they gave me a thumbs up. And they left, and we're in the car, and I looked at her and I said, I said, what is wrong with these people? She goes, what? They're letting us go with him. You ask her, she'll tell you. I actually said, this is not a joke, it's real. I said, we have no idea what to do next. Now what? He's ours. Do we leave him in the car seat forever? I figured that one out. Maybe just grow up in the car seat. I'm serious. I did, because there's no training. Oh, well, there was training, of course. You got to watch what happened in your own family that you grew up in, and that was wonderful. That prepared you. Now, hopefully some of us are doing a better job with our children. They are being better prepared because they're seeing a better example. But this is what, so here we are. We are looking at this example, and he said, but look, because you may not have selected because of character, maybe you selected because of beauty and physical things, then you can now be tempted by somebody else's physical beauty. And maybe something happens, and by the way, all of us tend to lose physical beauty or gain weight, or something happens, or we get injured or something. I mean, things happen. So if you're only looking at the beauty of the physical body, you're really going to miss it. And so then there will always be somebody younger, in better shape, better looking than you, always. But then we end up getting insecure and feel, because why? Because we're not trusting that we're rejoicing with the wife of our youth. And wives, your husbands may be looking at the stranger because you're not submissively supporting and encouraging and being the helpmeet that you need to be. So if you're not cheering him on like he's your biggest hero, somebody else will. And if they do, you may lose him. Because after all, that's what men need. Men need to be believed in. I trust you. I believe in you. Okay? That doesn't mean they're ever going to, you know, not make any mistakes. That they're never going to do that. But you have to, when they do make the mistake, instead of kicking them and saying, what's wrong with you? I knew I shouldn't have let you do that. I knew you'd mess it up. Ladies, you own those words? Instead, you look at them saying, I know you can fix it. I was never worried about it. Don't worry about it going wrong. I know you'll handle it. I know we're not going to get, you know, permanently damaged by this thing. I believe in you. You can do it. But that's not what's happening generally, right? He says, for why should you, my son, be captivated by a strange woman and embrace the bosom of a foreigner? For the ways of man are before the eyes of Yahweh, and he considers all his paths. So the ways of man, if you're doing this before Yahweh, you need to consider your paths. Most of us spend, like for those on the video who are listening, I'm counting on my hand as a sort of a metaphor, as a joke, because we consider our paths about 0% of the time. Okay? We spend almost no time thinking about what we're doing and where we're going. The average person does not plan anything in their life more than, you know what they plan? A vacation. You will spend more time planning a vacation than your career. You will. You'll do research and you'll figure out the best place and the best hotel and the best flights and the best, you'll spend days and weeks and months, but you'll spend no time planning your finances. And then you wonder why you don't have the finances you'd want to have. We don't consider our paths. We put our attention in all the wrong places, and we put all the effort in the wrong places. He says, but for the ways of man are before Yahweh, before the eyes of Yahweh, and he considers all his paths. The wrong one is entrapped in his own crookedness, and he is caught in the cords of his own sin. He dies for lack of discipline, and in the greatness of his folly, he goes astray. The whole chapter is about the context, the contrast of context between the right way of the path where he says, incline your ears to my wisdom. Listen to my wisdom, incline your ear to my understanding. Watch over discretion, guard knowledge. And comparing that to the woman with the dripping honey lips and she's got the tempting body and whatever, the things that would tempt you. Don't even go by her house. Don't even go and do these things. He says, stay away. Do not turn away. Keep away from there. Lest you, give your splendor away. The strangers are filled. And then what are you going to do? You're going to howl. I don't understand why all this stuff is happening to me. I don't know. Maybe because you did all this dumb stuff. See, but we don't think, we don't consider enough to figure out that there are going to be consequences. And then when the consequences come, we act like the 5-year-old, and when the consequence comes, they look at you like, what? You meant that? I'm really going to be punished? Or the hand comes, woof. Don't tell me when you ever spanked your kid, you ever didn't get a shocked look where they were surprised that you actually did it. What? Well, I said, if you do that again, I'm going to smack you. And so they go right over and do it again. And then they look at you shocked. We haven't changed very much. He always says, if you keep doing that, I'm going to smack you. So I'm going to let something happen that wakes you up, gets your attention. That's what the smack is supposed to be about. I'm not encouraging you to smack your kids. But things happen that are supposed to wake you up, get your attention. Hopefully that is if you are doing that, that's the only reason you did it, was give them a smack to wake them up and say, did I get your attention now? Good. Now that I got your attention, why don't we fix this problem and not do that ever again? That's what Yahweh tries to do with us. If we're listening, if we're paying attention, but more often than not, we're not. We're just not ready to hear that. We're not paying attention. We're not dealing with that. And so, you know, let's realize as we're going through this, the answer to this is what? Not dealing with this, not avoiding the voice of the teachers and not avoiding the ear listening. It's the teacher thing. It's the instructions. Are you going to let Yahweh teach you or are you going to try and teach him? Are you going to look for his instructors that he's anointed and appointed? Or are you going to teach yourself? Or are you just going to find people out there on every different, on this topic, I like to listen to so-and-so. On this other subject, I like to listen to so-and-so. And you just kind of bounce all over the place. Is that scripturally correct? No. I want to go deeper. Let there be a warning to all of you when we midrash in a couple of days. Because everybody's going to want to raise their hand and go into, what about in Daniel 9 and Matthew 24 and then over there in Revelation? Okay, you know what? Did you figure out how to love me and love him? Have you figured out how to walk the basics? Have you noticed that I've got over 300 or 400 teachings online, over 1,100 videos, and almost none of it has to do with deeper. Now, it has to do with deeper appreciation and a focus on basics. But I mean, when you say deeper, you meaning the more, higher level stuff. The more fun sounding stuff. Rabbi, when are we going to get to the deeper stuff? Well, I don't know, when you stop struggling with the basics. I'm not struggling with them. No, you wouldn't think that, would you? Because you don't have anybody to look at you and say you are. Because you haven't submitted yourself to be examined and held to account and had somebody say, this is where you're falling short. You know, I do, and a lot of you may not know this, I'm the director of the music. And the people that are up here playing when we rehearse have to allow and trust me to correct them if something's not right. If somebody sang something wrong, or the beat was wrong, or a note was wrong, or the chords didn't work, and we have to adjust and make other things. But they have to have enough respect that as musicians, which I'm not the way they do, I mean, I play trumpet really like they do, but we're not playing trumpet in this. But the guitar player, the keyboard player, the bass player, the drummer, the singers, the guitar, they all have to trust the conductor or the director. And you know what? They have to not get offended. They have to not take it personally. Because if I say, hey, you know, you were falling behind or you're rushing ahead, whether it's the guitar, the keyboard, the drum, or anything, they got to be like, well, I was on time. I was right on the beat. No, you're going to have to submit. And trust me, I'm sure you heard it the way you heard it. And that's the same thing. Now take that into Torah observance. I know you believe you got it down. But someone else watching may recognize that you're just off beat. Okay, maybe that's the best metaphor, because the beat isn't necessarily the drum. The bass maintains beat. The guitar maintains the beat. The keyboard maintains the beat. The singers have to be on beat, on the count. And that's why if you've ever watched a group, when the conductor's out, the conductor has his hand going to make sure that everybody is on the beat in sync with each other. And they use their hand as a visual. And that's really what we're doing here, is a teacher helps everybody get on the same count, on the same beat together. But you got a whole bunch of you that want to dance to your own drum and your own beat and your own rhythm. And if you've ever been in a place where anybody did that and they're playing instruments, it sounds like noise. All right? It sounds like noise. You ever listen when an orchestra is tuning up? A lot of times it sounds like noise because they're just, you know. Now, it doesn't sound as much like noise as you would think because they're all tuning to the same notes. But if they were tuning in totally different keys or different ways, it would sound like more like noise. Everybody's doing their own thing. Imagine it'd be like if the keyboard player and the guitar player and the drummer are all playing three different songs at the same time. But what's worse is you all think you're playing the same song and you're just off a little bit. And will you allow someone like myself to be say there, hey, you're going too slow, you got to move it up a little bit. Or you're going too fast, slow down and keep up with everybody here. We have to kind of keep it on the beat. Maybe that's a metaphor that works for some of you that understand music, okay? But as the person who directs all that, they have to, and I really appreciate the level of respect they've always shown me. I don't have the experience that most of them have in music, in working in studios, in working in bands, but they trust that I hear what I hear. And that part I have a gift for. But they have to show me the trust in that, right? And it would be so easy for me to go up to one and say something and they'll be like, oh, he just called me out and embarrassed me in front of everybody and told me I was off. We have to get that pride and ego out and be able to say, thank you, I appreciate that because I don't want to be off. Okay? Does that make sense? Okay? I'll give you another perfect example. We had a new person singing today. Okay? I'm not going to pick on him for that, but I'm saying is, but because he was new and singing, I had to give him the wisdom of, if you're fishing, in other words, you're kind of trying to figure out where to be on something, take the mic away a little bit, fish in quiet. Don't fish out loud. Do you understand what I'm saying? So some of you are fishing with something spiritually. Do it quietly. Do it by yourself. Don't do it out loud. A lot of you want to fish out loud with everybody. You want to. When I say fish, I mean you're searching for the note for a harmony or something. And so you said, oh, I think I can do this and it'll sound great as a harmony. And it doesn't always work. When it works, it's brilliant. When it doesn't, it's awful. And here's the sad part. Most of you don't have the ear for it. You wouldn't notice it anyway. But I would, and I'm the director. And I tell them, look, sometimes I'm picky and they'll look at me like, I'm like, I know nobody else will hear it, but you'll know it and I'll know it. When you listen back, you'll know it. And I'm listening now and I know it. And I'm here to help perfect that, right? But you guys out there are doing the same thing in your spiritual walk. You're trying to do this guesswork out loud. And you share with all your friends, hey, what do you think of this idea? I was kind of going in this direction. And why are you doing that out loud? If you're wrong, you're bringing everybody into that noise. Don't do that. So like I said to William, I said, if you got a fish, and he's new, so he has to do that a little bit. Bring the mic away while you're trying to say, I wonder if this will work. And then when you're confident, bring it back up. And that way, only people are hearing the stuff you're confident in. Okay, amen? So hopefully that was a good metaphor. Thank you for letting me use you for that. Okay? But this is what I'm trying to help you get, is to understand the depth of the approach to the basics. And the biggest part that you're going to struggle with of all of it is, will you take correction? Can you be corrected? We're going to finish here in just a second. But understand, the biggest thing that comes up that really gets hard for me is I feel really sad when a person will come up to me and ask me things like, well, I know you say you need a lot of help, but how come you don't ever pick me to help you? Now, that hasn't happened in a while, but it used to happen a lot a few years ago. And my answer, I couldn't tell them the truth. The truth was, you will always, at some point, did you work with anybody? You will always have that moment where you mess up. You cannot avoid at some point, you're going to disappoint the person you're working for or you're helping. The question is, how will you respond when they look you in the eye and say, that's not what I wanted, or that's not the right way, or that's, and then you, are you going to get crushed and get your feelings all hurt? Or are you going to say, thank you for sharing that with me because I didn't want to do that. I want to do it the way you want. Please show me so I can fix it. How are you going to handle that moment? And I've had many people that I do not use to help me because I know they won't handle that. They're not correctable. When I say not correctable, meaning that not that they won't make the change, but they can't emotionally handle correction. And where are you? Do this. Look at that mirror and do your own self-examination. How well do you handle correction? Well, you know, if they say it right and just the right tone of voice and everything, and blah, stop that. Was that the right tone of voice? Yes. Stop that, okay? Just knock that, just nothing, stop. You have to receive it no matter how it's delivered. Stop saying, if it was delivered right, I would have received it. That's a lie. That is your spin and justification. That is a lie. It didn't matter how it was delivered. You were not going to receive it. But you have what you believe is a defendable excuse, a plausible excuse. Don't lie and say, well, you know, because I do husband and wife things. Well, if she had just, or if he had just said it with a nicer voice, that is not the problem. Now, yes, they probably need to say things nicer, but that's still not the problem. Okay? Problem is that we do not like to be corrected. And it says it all through Scripture. The book tells you we do not like to be corrected, but if we allow for it, it brings the peaceable fruit. So we should trust the Word. Can't we trust the Word saying that we don't like it? And we already know we don't like it. There's no surprise. So with that said, let's go ahead and pray. Father, we come before you, and we just want to, first of all, thank you for helping us get through chapter 5. Yay! Which actually completes our journey through Proverbs, too, which is really exciting. So we're going to move on out of Proverbs. But Father, we want to glean and embrace what you're trying to tell us in chapter 5, which is to see and recognize where we are in the picture between the two choices there, between the one side with the wisdom, the understanding, and the discretion and knowledge, and the other with the smooth words and the honey lips and the things that would tempt us to go in a wrong direction, the place that would end up in a congregation where there's all evil, where things are just not being done correctly. So, Father, help us to embrace these things, especially to accept discipline, not to hate discipline, but to embrace that it's a needed thing, to not despise reproof, but embrace that it's needed. Not that we want to be disciplined or reproved, but that we accept the reality of it and the need for it. And that, Father, we would find those teachers and heed their voices and incline our ears to those that instruct us. So, Father, we come before you now just really appreciating that you put all this in words and how every time we read these words, we recognize in our own lives and the experiences we have how true your word always is. And so, Father, we are just strengthened in our belief. We're strengthened in our emunah, and we are just more and more confident every minute that we're in the right place, serving the right Elohim in the right manner. So, Father, we thank you. We praise you, asking for strength and guidance and wisdom and extreme patience as we go through this growth, that you would strengthen us and be patient with us. In the name of Yeshua, our Messiah, amen. Amen.